Hey there, action fans. I just woke up early on Friday morning to check AVClub.com and to see whether or not Tom Breihan picked Batman Begins for 2005, or if he picked Mr. and Mrs. Smith like I originally predicted. Turns out neither of those were right. It's a movie called Kill Zone, which I'd never heard of, starring Donnie Yen, who I'd only just heard of when Rogue One came out. And so that just goes to show you how much I know about action movies. So far, out of 23 Breihan's picks, I've only guessed 14 of them right, which puts my average at almost, but not quite, 61%. There we go. On to the review. Hi everyone, welcome back to my series, The Decades of Action Challenge, here on my channel. Inspired by the Epic Film Challenge, as hosted by Forkerball and Razor Wire Reviews, where they go through a book called 1001 Movies You Must See Before You Die, and watch some of the entries, make videos on them. I'm doing a series called A History of Violence, written by Tom Breihan for AVClub.com. It's about what Breihan considers the most important action movie of each year, starting with 1968 and moving forward to the present, 50 years of action movies. This year is 1991. Breihan's choice was Terminator 2 Judgment Day. And I have to say, I wasn't totally looking forward to rewatching this movie because I'd seen it 7 times in the theaters and even more times on at home. So it's like 20 times, roughly. And I knew, you know, I could probably recite most of the dialogue, like 70% of the dialogue from memory, because I'd seen it so much. So I was prepared to watch this and be a little bit bored. Surprisingly, only really bored by the first part of the movie. You know, you have the setup, you have the Terminators arrive, they're both looking for John Connor, one to protect him, one to kill him. And you have that big chase out of the mall, basically, where the kid, John Connor, Edward Furlong, is on a dirt bike. The T-1000 trying to kill him, Robert Patrick, he's in a tow truck chasing after him down the dried-up spillway. And Arnold Schwarzenegger, the Terminator, the one who's supposed to protect him, is back on his Harley and is chasing after them. And I love this scene. I actually put it on a compilation tape of favorite action scenes and watched it over and over and over again. It's one of my favorite chase scenes of all. And one of the reasons why I went back to see the movie, the whole movie in the theater 7 times, is because I wanted to see it on the big screen before it was gone, in particular that chase. You know, everything about it, that chase is great. It's only about 5 minutes long, so it's not one of the longest chase, but it just moves great, and, you know, it's just very, very well cut and shot, and I love it. And so the rest of the movie was just something I sort of had to sit through to get to those big set pieces, but this time was different. I think probably the last time I've watched this movie from beginning to end was probably sometime around 93 or so. Because I know I haven't seen the whole thing from beginning to end since I put that one scene on my compilation tape. And, you know, I don't know how many times I watched it in the year or two prior to that. That was around like 96 or so. So, yeah, watching this from beginning to end after over 20 years was a lot different than I expected. Things started to pick up for me after that chase, and once we have the kid talking with the robot and going, oh my goodness, you're really a Terminator, like my mom talked about, and Schwarzenegger's sitting there basically putting shells into the shotgun and not doing much of anything, just staring straight ahead while Edward Furlong is poking the bullet holes in his jacket and poking his cheek and everything like that. It's a funny movie. You know, I've always felt that way. I mean, when they announced that True Lies was going to be a comedy, more or less, people were like, what, a comedy? But I'm like, nah, you know, it can be funny, you know. James Cameron, the director, Terminator 2 is a really funny movie. And a lot of the humor, a lot of the best stuff for me comes with the kid. And which is funny, because a lot of people think, including Breihan, think that Edward Furlong's the weak link in the movie, you know, that Arnold's really, you know, fun, and Sarah Connor, Linda Hamilton, you know, as his mom, she's really, I'm not the Terminator's mom, obviously, John Connor's mom. She's really great. She's really intense and emotional. And she is, but, you know, things are livened up by the jokes. I was hoping to see the theatrical version without the extra scenes, which I don't all care for. But apparently that wasn't an option on the disc that I got. It's just the special edition, so all the extra scenes. Some of them are good. The computer scientist who's working on the early version of Skynet before Skynet becomes, you know, all-powerful and tries to kill all the humans and create Terminators in the future. He's played by Joe Morton, Miles Dyson. And he is, I think, a much stronger actor than any of the other three main characters. So having an additional scene with him in the movie with his family and his wife is not a bad thing. he's really good. And but everybody plays their part really well, I thought, for the most part. And I started to get really emotional, unexpectedly. I did clean my glasses multiple times during the course of this movie because I was actually spritzing on the inside of the lenses. There's a scene where Sarah basically tries to kill Dyson. She learns from the Terminator who's responsible for creating the neural net processor that makes Cyberdyne Company, gets them the military contract to build Skynet in the first place. So she's like, okay, he's the guy who developed the computer, so I need to kill him. And she sort of becomes the Terminator. She adopts Skynet's philosophy and says, if I just take out this one guy, everything will be fine. And, she misses with her rifle shot, and so she goes into the house, basically, where Miles and his family are, with a pistol, to finish him off, but she just can't do it. She stops herself, and that's like a really emotional moment, and I find myself, you know, unexpectedly having to clean my glasses over and over again. There were some other good moments earlier on. The whole nightmare sequence where she imagines, where Sarah Connor imagines the nuclear explosion killing all of Los Angeles, including herself and John, a younger, you know, version of herself in the old waitress uniform for the first movie. Yeah, there's a bunch of stuff like that that I just got kind of worked up about, unexpectedly so. It's not like I couldn't see any of it coming. I know this movie so well. I know, you know, shots by heart. I know all sorts of dialogue, the music cues, everything like that. I just remember it all so well, but experiencing again really sort of got to me. And I wonder if there are other movies that immediately follow this one from the 90s, which I'm going to feel sort of in a similar way. Like I said, I wasn't expecting to emotionally react to it the way I did. So maybe that's part of it. Maybe if I'm expecting to cry my eyes out during The Fugitive or Speed or Face Off, that's not going to happen. this movie came out in 91, of course, and that was immediately after I graduated high school. I was 18, and we went to see the movie in the theater, like, on its sneak night right before opening day, just before the July 4th holiday, the Independence Day holiday. And people were just, like, going insane for this movie, you know? They laughed really hard. They cheered really hard. They even cheered. One guy even cheered when, you know, at the very beginning of the movie, they show the future apocalypse, and it says Los Angeles 2029. Somebody goes, yeah! And another guy goes, it's only a freaking date, man! It's only a date! But that's how jacked everyone was for this movie, you know? I remember driving in the parking lot, And seeing how full it was of cars, everyone was going. And my friends, like, the Terminator, man, the first one's not a cult movie anymore. Everybody knows it. Everybody loves it. Everybody knows, I'll Be Back and Hasta La Vista and all that stuff. So, yeah, it was quite a pleasurable experience rewatching this. And I wasn't expecting that at all. I was expecting to just kind of, because I committed to, like, watching all these movies, all 50 of them, even though I knew some of them wouldn't be bad. And when I started this series, Breihan had just published his article on his 1992 movie, so he was halfway done. So I was like, okay, well, if I'm going to watch all of them, I'm going to watch all of them no matter what they are, even if he picks The Rock, which he did, from 96. I'm still going to rewatch it. I'm going to rewatch all of them, the ones, you know, that I've already seen, a dozen times or more, the ones I don't like. I'm going to rewatch them all. And this one, I was just like, it'll be okay, but I don't think it's going to be that exciting. And actually, I got super involved in the whole drama of the situation. And Sarah just, like, wanting to, like, you know, end her nightmares about the apocalypse and make sure Skynet doesn't exist. And of course, T-1000, the Robert Patrick character, you know, he's terrific in the movie. I think this is also actually the first movie that I ever saw Xander Berkeley in. Xander Berkeley plays John Connor's foster father. He and Jeanette Goldstein are his foster parents. Jeanette Goldstein played Vasquez in Aliens. And there's a fantastic scene that everyone just went nuts over when the T-1000 imitates one of them and kills the other one during a phone conversation. It's a really, really good scene. There's a bunch of just really, really cleverly well-staged scenes in this movie. And, you know, I've tended to, like, you know, think less of Cameron since Titanic was, you know, whatever that was, and Avatar I didn't care for that much. But, yeah, he's you know, he's kind of a master. You know, he's kind of, you know, ingeniously, you know, just knows the best way, the most fun way to pull off these scenes. And there's very little weak material in this movie as far as I'm concerned. Like I said, I was a little bit bored during the first part just because it was all just them hunting down John Connor. But there's some really good moments in there. I love the scene. There's a quick shot where Edward Furlong is on his dirt bike and he speeds through the alley in the background, and then in the foreground suddenly a tire from the Harley stops in the frame and the camera booms up to see Schwarzenegger there scanning around looking for John Connor. Oh, and I looked at the end credits and Nikki Cox is in this movie. Nikki Cox is an actress who married Bobcat Goldthwait. She's been in a bunch of different TV shows over the years, but she's the little girl that tells Robert Patrick, the T-1000, that John Connor said he was going to the mall. The mall sequence is really fun. I'd say probably the only action sequence that I'm not crazy about is the one at the end where they get in the truck, basically, and they're pursued by the T-1000, the helicopter, and then both vehicles crash, and they both get new vehicles and chase after each other again, and they end up in the steel mill. That goes on for a really, really, really long time. But they have to end up in the steel mill because all that molten metal is, like, the only way they can kill the guy. So, luckily, they ended up there. Anyway, so that's my little video on Terminator 2. A fun movie, you know, a well-made movie, one that I enjoyed a lot more on this viewing that I was expecting to. And next week I'll be doing John Woo's other big Chow Yun-Fat action film called Hard Boiled. That's Breihan's pick from 92. So I hope you'll tune in for that next week. And below in the links you'll find Breihan's article on Terminator 2 and the link to my playlist where all these videos that I'm doing for this series are, my Facebook page, of course. Thanks again for watching. I'll see you again next time. Take it easy.